topic to debate today, and an equally interesting and diverse group of panelists to debate it with. And the panel has been chosen with fairly careful deliberation. There should be insights and perspectives which will enrich the thought process in this area. I'm going to kick off by asking the end objective of this whole session, and I will sort of loosely conduct it and expect the panelists to step in when they have a point based on whatever somebody else has said. The end objective really is to see whether we can widen the base of impact investors from angel investors, which is what it is today, into a more diverse group of HNIs, family foundations, SMEs, larger corporates. And the second part, so one is widening, and the second part is really to see if we can, you know, deepen the interest of those who are already investing into it to make it a little bit of more than money. In other words, you know, can they impact the non-financial aspects of early stage enterprises as well? I'll start by asking my colleague Aditi to talk, to define on a broader scale what impact investments really is, share a few headline numbers on the impact industry, and much more importantly, talk about her experience of developing the impact network and the challenges that she's facing as she's growing this network. Aditi.
Thank you. So I will talk a little bit about the overview of this industry and what's been happening so far. So if you look at how impact investing has grown, the term itself is very, very new. And it's very niche, and only very lately do you see sort of publications coming out in the Economic Times, Financial Express, etc. So what we are trying to do here is get domestic capital involved, domestic investors involved. So there's a lot of money in this space, and I think over, depending on how you sort of bracket it and how you define it, over 200 deals have happened in this space over, say, the past 14 years or so. So how are we defining impact? Everybody has their own definition. We say, you know, for-profit enterprises, so we're limiting ourselves to for-profit when we talk about social enterprises, that are catering to the bottom of the pyramid, affordable products and services, you know, both rural and urban markets, or who are creating an environmental impact. So there's social and there's environmental. So those are the kind of companies that we're talking about. And we are looking at, you know, about 7 focus sectors, including, you know, what you've heard, you know, about in the conference so far. So a lot of money in this space is foreign, and it's all sort of sitting in the funds. And so what's happening is after friends and family investment, promoters putting their own money, or maybe some incubator or awards money, there's a huge financing gap before getting to the level where the funds can actually put in the money. And this is sort of a general landscape. So we are trying to plug that gap in, right? And how we're trying to do it is by getting domestic money, you know, from individual investors. Couple of reasons for that. One reason is, of course, because other than money, there's a lot of local expertise to be added. There's a lot of networks to be opened. So, you know, that's one reason. And the other reason is there are angel networks all over India. So, you know, initially you start with the metros, but you can go, you know, all over India. So about 200 deals. Out of that, 95% is foreign capital. I think the total deal size, if you look at in $1 million in dollar terms, is probably about 1.5 billion or so. And of course, that includes microfinance. So, you know, there's 50% of that is probably microfinance. And out of that, about 70 crores or so can be identified as early stage deals. So it's tiny, about 11 million compared to 1.5 billion. Right, is early stage deals, and how we define that is angels, I mean, you know, in a half a million and lower type of range. So when we started this network about 2 years ago, we, you know, went out to high net worth individuals, family offices, and in fact, first we reached out to the ultra high net worths. And what we saw was that although there was a lot of interest, they had no time to actually actively, you know, mentor the enterprise, and in fact even look at the opportunities that we were showing them. And the other thing was that also, you know, they were very conscious about what their names get associated with in terms of small enterprises. So we shifted our focus to go after high net worth individuals who were serial entrepreneurs or who were sort of high level executives in corporates. And we've grown the network to about 50 investors. The challenges we've had in the process is that a lot of people ask, okay, what is this impact investing social enterprise? I make money doing mainstream investments, and I do good with philanthropy. What is this weird space in the middle? And how do I think about it? Do I think about it in money-making terms? Are there trade-offs with social impact and financial returns? So how do I think about it? So I think that has been one of the main challenges, convincing investors and trying to talk, to educate them about what we mean when we're in this space.
Let me stop you there and bring Pranay in the picture there. So Pranay is a high net worth individual. He invests in a variety of asset classes. So let me start by asking you, why not impact investments?
Well, it's a very good question. And what happens is that as you progress in life, your approach also keeps changing. 10 years back, what would I look at? If I make an investment, do you get a tax break? Mm-hmm. Is the government supporting you? Mm-hmm. Are you able to kind of get some quid pro quo or a return against the investment that you're making? These were some of the things which weighed in your mind. Mm-hmm. Or what weighed in your mind was, or is there a compulsion for you to do this? Mm-hmm. One is, of course, it's a stick and carrot thing. Either the carrot or the stick worked, and therefore you ended up making some investment. You didn't always think of the ultimate impact that it would have. Well, like I told you, as you progress in life, you begin to think about a payback to the society. And that's the time you really kind of look at the returns. Should you be expecting 22%, 25%, 20%? Or for an ethical investment, you could possibly settle for 12 or 15%. I think now what we're talking about are those kind of investments where the returns could be a little less, but the fulfillment, the pleasure, is much, much more. May I give an example? I mean, if we have the time. For the last few years, I've been connected with an old age home, which we have set up on a 25-acre plot of land near Deral. And what do we find? That over 10, 11% of the Indian population today is over 60 years of age. You have a number of NRIs who would like their parents to be looked after well. So if you were to set up an old age home, obviously you can't get the pricing that you would expect to get out of a luxury housing that you create. But you settle for something less, where the returns are also more moderate, but the fulfillment of having provided housing to the elderly and looking after the other needs, going beyond housing, emotionally kind of looking after them, is something which I think has worked very well and has appealed to me. And I think this is the reason why I'm getting more and more into this investment, which I was not earlier, and that's the reason.
There are a number of things, Pranay, that you touched upon, the last being this whole emotional aspect which comes in an investor's life stage at a certain point in time. And this whole thing, between portfolio return and the whole emotive aspect is something as a thread I want to bring in a little bit later in the course of this discussion. But before that, just one more very direct question to you. While I understand, that you look at, a carrot, a stick, and some degree of moral suasion, if one may call it that, to get influenced into getting into this. If at this stage one were to ask you, you're looking at various asset classes in your portfolio, and if I were to say, I'm an ex-private banker, that would you consider this? What are the typical objections, if I may, that come to your mind? We understand the emotional fulfillment, but for you to view it as an asset class, what would you look for?
I think first and foremost, the implementation part of it. Because money is just one of the ingredients for the success of any project. You know, I'll come back to the old age home. Mm-hmm. You know. I mean, you can create the brick and mortar out of that money, mm-hmm. but can you really look after those people? Okay. Are you having the software, so to say, you know, to kind of do that? Because the hardware is something you can create with money. Mm-hmm. You know. Mm-hmm. So I would look at the ability of the entrepreneur mm-hmm. to implement the project you know, okay. and see it to its logical conclusion, so to say.
Okay. So the monitoring and the end use of the funds is what you're
yes,
saying.
Yes, that's one thing. Secondly, being an accountant, I would not tolerate a losing proposal. Mm-hmm. I mean, it can break even, it can make some money, but if it's losing mm-hmm. and if it requires additional capital input every now and then, mm-hmm. the growth suffers. Mm-hmm. In fact, one of the ways to do it is to, when you make that investment, you tell yourself mm-hmm. that you are not expecting to get anything out of this project, but whatever the project makes, you plow it back into the project so it goes for growth. Mm-hmm. You know, mm-hmm. I think that is what has been kind of weighing in my mind. Yeah,
Naveen. You know, as I said, we've chosen the panelists with some careful deliberation. So we move from somebody who I would call in that sense uninitiated. He's an investor, but has not invested, Pranay has not invested into impact, to Naveen, who's also a high net worth individual, who is actually an angel investor and is actually part of the IQBN network. So the question to you, Naveen, is what brought you into this to start with?
So I'll be very frank with you. I've actually been wrapped in corporate world for about 40 years. And so I did what is normally called entrepreneurial work within the corporation. And I actually, now that you asked this question and I've reflected a bit, is when I go back to my career in corporation, those aspects, those facets of my life, when I was working with the Eta Dairy in Hindustan Lever, I like the idea of collecting milk from farmers, you know, something like an Amul dairy kind of a thing, which actually rewarded them. There was another exercise which the company did in terms of getting peas. You know, those of you remember Hema peas, etc. Again, creating wealth for the company at the same time, creating activity and value for farmers. Then I was involved in the AFS business again, Hindustan Lever. Then again, you could see. So therefore, looking back, I can now see that I like those chapters of my life where I actually did some nice things which were beyond actually looking for growth and career and progress and recognition and reward and incentive. They were important. Yes, they were important to survive in the world as a thing. But if I had that added bit, I seem to have had a higher energy to do those things. So I would go back to that. And then when I came out of this, and I must thank my son for this, I hadn't understood the private equity or venture capital, you know, words to me. But he had done something here. He was an entrepreneur himself and he sort of set up a company many years ago. Then he sort of got out of it, etc. So he said, you're retiring, would you like to get into this area? And I must say, that's how I was initiated into this and turned like angel investment or venture capital investment or whatever private equity, you know, Series A, Series B. I've learned last year and a half, so that's where I am.
And angel investments, social enterprises, did that just happen as part of angel investing, or was there a very sort of deliberately chosen policy, or it just happened?
No, it is actually. When I did start, we actually went into an investment which was well beyond the angel. It was almost like a day investment. But the reason why I went into that investment was it was done because the company was started by BP and they were wanting to get out of it. Because, and it was very nice. It was actually in the area of creating these cook stoves and pellets for the poorer sections of society, whatever the pyramid, making it, energy available to them at a price which is significantly lower than the LPG, which was not available at the time. And I was actually a bit of a mentor here in my corporate days with this particular project. So, and I sat with eminent people like C.K. Prahlad, who actually got this work together. But this company was floundering, it was about to close. And they were friends of mine, and they needed some capital and was not available. So I sat with them and I said, what can you do with this? And they then proposed an idea which seemed to be a proposition which would make it commercially viable. So I put some capital in that, which actually worked because the new idea worked very well. Then they needed to scale it up, etc. For that they needed some money. And they looked around. At that time the response was from some venture capital funds, I'll give you large sums of money and I'll take huge shares. And I found that unfair. And I said, you know, you're just taking away arm and a leg of a company which has been built up by these people who sacrifice their career. So I said, look, I'm happy to give it in the same term, much diluted. There won't be any ratchet, there won't be anything, because I know you. And I'll give it to you subject to performance. That's how I came into it. But just coming to the last part, that was a big one, which by the way is doing quite well now, in fact. And then over a period of time, I found that, you know, if you do big ones, you don't have the opportunity of participating in the wide arena which exists out there. And I was quite excited when my son started getting me small bits. And I met very young people, you know, progressive, you know, technology, looking at newer ideas, etc. And I said, well, I must move into that particular space. So I'm now part of networks and do a little bit of angel networking, but do something in between as well. But I'm not there now in the big ones. That's my history.
And just two quick questions before we move on. One is, you know, from now on, from your current experience of being in, again, I come back to impact investments as a subpart of angel investments, because that obviously encompasses all early stage investments, and here we're talking about investments which have a developmental impact. Would that always form a part of your portfolio?
Yes. In fact, now I've decided very clearly that I will be in this part, which is about impact, because it's just so good. Because, you know, and I just want to build a little bit on that.
Absolutely.
I couldn't agree more with what was said by Pranay. And being a marketeer by profession, I try to look at it in the context of what happens to the mind of the investor as a person who's doing something. And I said that for any marketer, they need to understand what is the rational and emotional motivation. And if I look at this community of high net worth individuals or groups, there are two motivations. One's a rational motivation, and the other is emotional motivation. And rational motivation could be things like, I want to have a better lifestyle, etc., I want to have savings, etc. But you know, when you already are in HNI, you know, you achieve that stage, you're not looking for a better lifestyle. Unless you belong to those few people. But even on the emotional side, there are two things. One is an emotional need to go to the next level of having wealth, and that could be driven by ego, that could be driven by actually sort of setting examples for the next generation. Okay? So those are the emotional needs. And the other emotional need is what you said again is, I want to give it back to the society, I want to be part of something, I want to give back my expertise, etc., without actually losing the value. This we are taught, actually, you cannot be doing anything which actually decimates value. So that's a condition. So in that particular thing, I now find that the emotional need, which is about doing something with my knowledge, my expertise, and a little bit of wealth, if it gives it back, and it's so fascinating. Day after tomorrow, I'm going to a place to look at a project which is being evaluated. And when I got a feedback of what this project is doing, there were these numbers which says what money it will make, but there were page which said the employment has gone up by this, the income has gone up from 75 rupees per day to 200 rupees per day. It's actually created so much of employment. It was so fascinating. I just saw that part and said this actually the barrier.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? The money will come, it doesn't matter. So therefore, I just want to substantiate my inner feeling which
And just again a related question before we move on. If I were to ask you for help in terms of expanding this or widening this group of investors, there are a set of circumstances that brought you in. Your son played a role. You spoke about one of those investments which did very well. If we want to widen this base, and I ask for your assistance, what would you say? What were the things that we need to do to take this to a much larger group of HNIs and foundations?
So, going back to the way I said, with my marketing background in brand and consumer, when you as an asset manager, when you have a set of people who are actually approaching people who've got that income, you have to position the product appropriately. Okay? Mm-hmm. And any product which you buy, whether it's soap or service, etc., there is a rational justification and there's an emotional justification. So if you're looking at those people who want to invest in social investment, you must understand that they have a bigger emotional need of doing things which, you know, I talked about. So you have to position it that way, that this is what you will get. And you know, you have to give an example. What does this mean? How will it satisfy this particular need of yours? So it's really about presenting it, positioning it with examples which have been done, with what's available on the plate and what you could do out here, all the time telling them that there's a risk factor. It's not a cakewalk kind of stuff. But I think these people who have lived their life and created their wealth understanding what risk is. So I think it's a marketing activity. We have to position this product very clearly in the mind of the target consumer. You've got to check that. Not everybody will be in the same frame. The ratio of emotional and rational needs may change. You have to find those people who've got greater need for emotional needs and then offer the product.
Okay. Amar.
Can I add just one more thing?
Sure. Absolutely.
And therefore, and then you have to deepen this. Like, deepen the consumption by actually taking such people to places where things are being done by demonstrating to them. You can show this is what's happened. This is what it was before, this is what it is. Proof of the pudding, and then these people who are already into this net will do more and more.
Okay. So, Amar, thanks Naveen, that's very useful, and there's one thread I want to carry through from there, which is again coming back to this whole thing that the whole emotional aspect of this married to the whole rational aspect, which needs to be kind of packaged well and taken to a client. My question is, if there is such a strong emotional connection in this, which means the person need to be personally involved, what role, if any, does a private wealth advisor play in it? Does the private wealth advisor have any role in it?
I think, I've been a banker for 20 years myself, and I've seen there's a mindset that's got evolved for issues which are socially relevant, economically relevant, and we see that across the spectrum of social and economic classes. Now, I myself have been a banker for 20 years, and today I sit here in my individual capacity out of my interest affiliation for this thought that when we are growing as an economy, as a country, we need to do something for the rural and socially relevant causes. So over here, like both the earlier panelists have said, that the mindset is very important in terms of contributing to that. Clearly, the return comes secondary. Because over here is the mindset, it's the sense of achievement that you have contributed to the progress of something which otherwise wouldn't have happened by getting a bank finance. So here you're contributing as an individual to the development in the rural areas, in areas where a normal businessman may not venture out of pure profits. So first comes the mindset, and so making aware about this cause is again because maybe as a wealth advisor, a person may want to talk about the total activity, and unlike overseas, philanthropy is not a part of any product suite in India. So I think it would be in the individual capacity out of interest that you will have to position it to the people you know and spread the awareness. Because like I think Pranay also mentioned, calls for monitoring, it calls for correct implementation also. So first comes the mindset, and once the client has, the investor has the mindset, then the awareness can be created, yes, of course. So in the course of discussion, if I know that there is a mindset of an individual who is interested in investing and contributing to such sectors, then one can always put him across to an impact official who can take it up.
At a Amar, at a more granular level, right? I've been a private banker myself. How do you, what are the aids? What do you really require yourself on this particular, impact investment area to equip you to actually position it to a client? What are the aids you need? What would make you feel comfortable to say, this is an investment idea I want to take to a client? what needs to be wrapped around it, you know, tell us, you know, because you, for it to be an asset class worth your while to look at it, you need something to be around it. What is it that you can take to a client?
At this point, it's at a very initial stage and a bit at a premature stage where we would need to put it across as that. It will be looked at as a different idea to a client where to be equipped, you need a complete information on these, on the relevance of these with a long-term outlook and a sense of social fulfillment. So to make aware or the intermediary is far more important because then he may be able to spread the message in a far more meaningful manner, because just being aware about a booklet or something, no, but a session, a training session, interactive session with people or the people who need those money, a direct connect with them and understanding what they are, because one session which I attended earlier with you, there were a lot of professionals from IITs and IIMs who had left their jobs and have started these small initiatives. Someone was making lamps, someone was making pumps and going to villages, and that was really encouraging, which gave me thinking that here are people who could have earned billions of dollars in an MNC but are contributing to social development. So interacting with those people will equip more in terms of building confidence, because basically it's a confidence building exercise even for the intermediary to take it forward. So that confidence will build up once there's a direct connect with the people who are implementing these projects, who are managing these projects, and of course there's an impact advisor always by your side who would then give the things around it. So it's more interaction, more first-hand interaction with the people who are actually doing at the grassroots levels.
And, you know, Satya, if I were to sort of flip this question around, you know, we've kept talking about this whole emotional connection and this whole thread, the whole developmental piece. Suppose, you know, for a minute, if you were to just take that deliberately out and just look at it the way we look at a portfolio in a very hard-nosed, cut-and-dried manner and look at returns, right? So you have debt, you have equity, and you have a risk-return equation which runs through that entire trajectory. And you have private equity sitting right at the end, which is, you know, the highest risk and the highest return. And you take away emotion from that completely, because one of the things which I've learned is, you know, high net worth individuals are individuals with only one commonality, which is a large sum of money. What they aspire to do with it, how they deal with it, how they want that managed, how they want it reported, is completely customized for each person, right? So while there would be people with a social conscience, I would dare say there would be a lot who may not give a damn, so to speak. But we still want to widen the net, and we would still want to bring them in. Is there a way, Satya, with what's happened in the country so far, that you can actually position it as a pure investment idea which stands on its own legs, or does the emotive aspect need to come in?
Okay, so Satya, you have given me a difficult question to answer, but let me, it's an emotive question, but let me give my little experience from a logical perspective, because that possibly will resonate well with the people sitting here. So let's look at this emotional aspect in a logical manner. So if I give you a phone and a camera separately, would you like that option if I give you camera with phone? The logical answer to this is, I think if we get a camera and phone together, which most of us have today, we'll opt for it, provided it works both ways. Now let's look at in our own lifestyle, on our own way, and I think most of us we'll have some reflection at some point in our life. We end up creating wealth in our life at some stage. I mean, we end up spending our time creating wealth. And then we start discussing what to do with it. Shall I give it to my son, daughter, my niece, nephew, this philanthropy, that charity? Or finally, it may be taken away by somebody by some sheer stroke of some misfortune. In any case, the wealth has to be put to some use. So creating the wealth and putting the wealth to use is like camera and phone. If you can both create the wealth and possibly put to use at the same time, I think that could be a logical answer to most of the things that we are asking for. Now, but it doesn't really happen that way. So I think we need to first and foremost understand what this business of investment is all about and what is the social impact that we try to understand. First and foremost, I would like to put this question to most of the people whom I come across, that what do you understand by doing business? Most of the people will answer it, business is some activity which you do for creating some profit or creating some wealth. in my limited understanding, I believe that business itself is the biggest philanthropic activity one can undertake in this, on this planet. So whatever business you are in, at the moment you are doing a business, you are the biggest philanthropist. Because through that business, you try to create wealth. Through that business, you try to provide employment. You provide economically viable activities to society at large that helps to generate some taxes for the government to take care of our welfare. So if there is no business, there's no philanthropy possible. So business is a motherhood statement for any philanthropist, whatever business you are in. Now, that does not mean that you should get into business with unethical practices. That I'm let's keep some of those exceptions away. So I believe that biggest charity people can think of is to get into some sort of business, either themselves or helping somebody else to create businesses. Now, the moment you do business with little more social consciousness, I call it social impact business. Now, that's a very, very wider definition of a business. But any business done with good amount of social consciousness, because then you will be very careful as to which direction you need to charter, and I think that will become social impact. Now, the moment you want to give a restrictive definition, I believe, yes, you can do business with social consciousness, but where ROE or getting the maximum amount of return on investment is not the only objective. You are also looking at wider impact that you are creating along with it. And that becomes little more, you can say, social impact investment. So when it comes to most of the high net worth families, like we deal with some of the large high net worth families in the country, and very often when we talk about their lifestyle, the success and planning part of it, philanthropy is definitely one of the area that you need to address it. And each of these families have their own preferences for how they want to do philanthropic activities, because ultimately the wealth has to put to use. And by the way, why are we talking about the current generation? Even if you look back our traditions, almost in every religion, there is a concept called purification of wealth. Okay? Dharam ki, dhan ki suddhi. The purification of wealth actually means that unless you purify the wealth is not going to stay with you. In Sanskrit, I don't know how many of you understand Sanskrit, but let me tell you, when you talk about goddess of wealth, Lakshmi, there is another name of this goddess of wealth called Chanchala. So the goddess of wealth is never stable. And there is a secret of goddess of wealth to make stable around you is to purify the wealth. And that's the reason you talk about Hindu dharma, or you talk about Muslim dharma, or you talk about Christian religion. Whichever religion you talk about, every religion talks about purification of wealth. So philanthropy is given. Okay? You are not doing philanthropy for any social cause. Okay? Let me first emphasize on it. Philanthropy is to be done to protect the wealth around you. Okay? So you are doing it for selfish reason. If that is what to be done, so here you have objective of wealth creation, here your objective of purification of wealth or philanthropy. If you can combine it together, that's what social impact investing is all about. Now, give it whatever name you want to call it. Angel investing, social investing, investing with social consciousness, doing business with social consciousness. All those are names that is given by many of us, the so-called learned people. But even in our ancient India, our traditional, lot of literatures that you come across, I think this has been very common. So what I keep telling everyone is that if you have a philanthropic objective somewhere in your life, possibly this is the first step to take forward. And this resonates very well with business families for simple reason, because they understand the language of business. So the moment you go to them, and I give you a simple example, you go to them and say, hey guys, we want to create this particular venture or this particular philanthropic where you need to give so much money. The question which arises in any logical person's mind at that stage is, shall I give this much money? Have I created enough to give? Is it not too much to give? Because the moment you cut the check, you feel as if this money has gone. Okay? And somewhere that logic in our mind doesn't really strike right balance all the time. Okay? More often than not, people still are undecided where they've created enough wealth to give. Is it the right time to give? So the moment you go to them and saying that, no, I'm not taking any money away from you. This money belongs to you. It is coming for a particular investment. which is also going to give you some return, hopefully. But at least you will get your money back in most of the cases. And it will also create social impact or philanthropic impact indirectly without you even directly contributing to it. I think it resonates well. I'll give an example. And this is something related to microfinance sector. I came across a very interesting individual recently. And he said, I am in the microfinance. Now, traditionally, our way of microfinance is that you give them equity. Okay? They raise some debt from bank in whichever manner or some international agencies. And they try to create a lot of social impact. Microfinance is not a subject that I need to speak on, at least in this forum. Now, this individual is very unique. He came up saying that I am running microfinance institution in slums of Mumbai. Very good. But I don't need any equity. Very interesting. You only give me money if you have little money spare. I'll return the money without interest to you. Okay? Now, if you go to somebody saying that, okay, give me a few lakhs rupees and I'll return this money whenever you want at call. Obviously, you have to give me a few months notice. But I'll give it to you without interest. So, you are not charging interest. This fellow actually is creating, you can say, the impact by taking your interest money away. So, he's saying that your principal is with you. Now, this is a new format of social impact investing. So, if you go to somebody and say, I want 10 lakhs rupees because I want to give it to these poor women in slums, maybe you will not give it. But as long as you believe in this guy that this fellow will bring the money back, maybe you can give a larger amount of money. Give you another example. You talk about social impact investing and you're talking about, let's take about healthcare as a sector, education as a sector, or you can talk about e-commerce as a sector. If any of these sectors, you go to them and seek charitable funds, it's very difficult to convince most people. And even if they get convinced, they will cut the check at least 1/20th of the size that they are capable of. And the check will be cut not because of the cause that you are supporting, but because who is the person asking for the money. So if I go, if Pranay goes, maybe he can get a better money than me. Maybe Naveen, because he can convince them little more emotionally, he will cut a larger check. But what I am saying is that here is the cause and the fellow who is asking for the cause. But the moment you go for something like this, here we are saying this is a logically you understand what you are asking for. And maybe you will have much larger amount to ask for. So it's not a choice. You just need to make it right packaging.
Satya, on that, on this whole aspect that you spoke about, I want to find out if there is a take from Pranay and Naveen. Which is, you know, what you're doing here is essentially marrying two objectives, right? Which is your phone and camera example. You're marrying philanthropy and you're marrying return. Now, there are a lot of clients who may want to deliberately keep it clean. This is my portfolio. I want a return out of it. I look at it purely on commercial terms. I also want to give back. I do that separately. I give money to an NGO which is doing something for the poorest of the poor or in a sector which is close to me. What you're doing here is essentially marrying two objectives, and sometimes there is a fear, there is a skepticism in a client's mind that by marrying two objectives, you actually mess it up in simple terms. What's your take on it? I mean, I know you're invested in it. So was there ever a dichotomy in your mind? And if so, how did you resolve it?
So, again, drawing from the way I see things, people out there are not homogeneous.
Mm-hmm.
There are some people who are like that I want to have return on my capital. Some people at the other end don't care about it. It's all actually donations and philanthropy.
Mm-hmm.
And some people are in between.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So I think you have to have horses for courses.
Mm-hmm.
If you are actually building a network or a community of people who are interested in social investing,
mm-hmm.
then you have to keep away from the people on the left side.
Mm-hmm.
Because, you know, then there is another asset manager who can do this.
Correct.
You have to understand that you have to have a proposition that suits
mm-hmm.
the need,
mm-hmm.
and I go back to the word, the
mm-hmm.
rational need and the
mm-hmm.
emotional need in the mix,
mm-hmm.
which he or she wants.
Mm-hmm.
And this happens all the time in products and services, etc.
Mm-hmm.
That's why you have multiple brands.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, because mm-hmm. they are meeting different mixes.
Mm-hmm.
And therefore, you can actually, and as he very nicely said,
mm-hmm.
that you can have the camera and stuff.
Mm-hmm.
So therefore, you give the camera and the phone together to those people who
want it.
In those who don't want it, if you push it, then you will feel unsuccessful. Mm-hmm. So that's one thing. Mm-hmm. And can I actually, this suppose we were talking about this group earlier, I said, you know, we should not be rigorously aligned. We must have some little bit of challenge. So can I bring that little challenge in now?
Absolutely.
Okay, so this purification of wealth is a fantastic concept, because I think this is true. In an environment where the wealth has been in the past largely created by looking at opportunities, not in a win-win fashion, but in a win-lose fashion. Mm. There's an intrinsic guilt in the people. Mm. Either there's an avoidance of tax which deprives society, or it's deprivation of income, of rightful income. So therefore, that purification of wealth has been there, certainly by the family houses, who are now sitting on assets, which are huge. Because they ignored it or they knew it, etc. But I want to build on that is out of fear syndrome. Mm. If you really want to go forward in terms of build a community of people who are looking at it, not from a fear syndrome or they having done something wrong and I'm correcting it, build on the concept that it may still be the purification. I've done something good, but I want to do something better. Mm. To enhance it. And therefore, that's where the positioning of your product comes. Mm. In terms of the duality, that you meet your requirement of 12%, 15%, whatever, this is the threshold or whatever barrier you cross. Mm. And after that, what you're doing is a value creation, which is for the people out there, and this gives you a feedback in your mind that I'm creating value in my own mind. Because emotional need is nothing but value creation for myself. Mm. Okay. And therefore, again, that purification has to be looked at in a different fashion. How do you leverage this idea going into the future?
Okay. Just quick take on from
I have a point. Yeah.
Okay. Sure.
So,
can I also react to that?
Yeah. Sure.
Yeah. Then you get it.
No, you go first.
Well, I have a slightly different point of view, and in line with what you said about differing, I don't think it is right to expect that one size fits all. What I mean thereby is that people understand a certain line of business. There are things which are beyond their comprehension, and therefore they are unwilling to kind of fund something which they don't understand. I feel that when you are taking a proposal to an investor, if you take it to an investor who understands that line of business, he's more readily willing to fund it. Let me give you an example. Say I'm connected with real estate, and somebody comes to me with, say, a project for affordable housing, and I'm able to ask him 10 questions on what technology are you using, how much is the mix of the cement, you know, what price you are buying sand at, and labor, and this and that, and all. I'm more willing to cut that check out, you know, if I understand what I'm doing. As opposed to somebody coming to me with, say, a very high funda software project, you know, which I don't understand, you know. And all that I'm asking him then is, can somebody copy what you're doing? And he says, I'm not sure, because everybody has copied everything in software over the last 25 years, you know. So then you say, A, am I giving money for the right purpose? You know. So I think the most important thing, Naveen, I also feel, is that people want to fund that line of business which they understand, you know, which they're able to kind of monitor as we go along, because, you know, once you made the investment, you obviously want to see what's happening to that investment. So you're able to kind of closely watch that, you know, get the feedback, and most importantly, provide mentoring when needed, because you understand that.
So I fully agree with you, actually.
Yeah.
So, I'm not saying, in fact, people are more comfortable in the area of expertise with women, because that actually satisfies that desire that I must give it back.
Yeah.
Just one thing related to this to Pranay before we jump to you. You know, what you mentioned is absolutely right. I mean, what you're comfortable with, even in the set of social enterprises, what you're comfortable with is what you're more likely to invest into, because you understand that better. But just going back to that question again, which we've seen a lot of HNIs, to ask you a direct question relating to yourself. Would you like to keep the two separate, your portfolio as one, and you have a social conscience, you want to give back, you do philanthropic activities separately. why this whole thing called impact investments, which is a marriage of two, since you've not done it, would you want to put it as part of a portfolio? What would be the questions in your mind?
I think that's a very fair question to ask. And what I would do, and which may not be valid for others,
sure,
is to earmark a certain portion of my wealth, which I feel I can devote to this, and which I consider more risky than anything else which I'm doing.
Okay.
If I'm putting it in debt, if I'm putting it in shares of the first 30 companies, the top 30 companies, I know I'm taking minimal risk. But here, I'm funding a venture which can disappear from the face of the earth for all you know. Or the person can disappear. Or, you know, he throws up his hands or whatever it is. So it is the most risky form of investment. And at this age then, I want to just earmark a certain portion, whether it's 10 or 15%, you know, to be invested into this high risk, but emotionally very satisfying investment.
All yours.
Actually, Rana has made a couple of points that I wanted to make. So, you know, just I just wanted to react to a couple of things that that you all said. So, first of all, I think that's going to be my elevator pitch from next time. Whenever I go to an H&M, I'm going to be like, you know, dhan ki shuddhi. And get them on board. But see, I wanted to talk a little also about the react to the emotional versus rational quotient, right? See, the difference between philanthropy and impact, you know, when I'm talking to people, the set of people that I've spoken to, is that they don't try to rationalize philanthropy at all. But when you talk about for-profit, you mention the return, it switches to the rational side. And it's almost a 90% switch. So then what happens is, and you know, this has been one of the challenges as well, and Pranay touched on it, I will invest in what I understand. Usually in India, the way you know, wealth has grown mostly in technology sector, you know, technology, IT, and so they understand e-commerce, mobile, all of that very well. And also, you know, a lot of the stuff is being, you know, sort of taken from the West. So there are proven models there, you just have to replicate it here. Whereas if I tell you poultry, dairy, Orissa, I don't, forget about poultry, dairy, I don't even understand Orissa. I've never been there. I don't plan to go there in the near future. You know, so how do I rationalize? How do I assess? I don't know how, but you know, what the weight of the chickens need to be before they're sold. I don't know anything about the supply chain there. So there's a lot of you know, sort of awareness building and knowledge building that we do actually as a part. And you know this. You've been on some of those calls. So I think that is something which we need to address. You know, do you have to, you know, how do you stop from fully switching to the rational side? And if you do switch, then how do you build the awareness about some of these sectors that have not ever traditionally been looked at as investable, right? And how about the geographies? You know, when you talk about Orissa, when you talk about Northeast, when you talk about Bihar, UP, political risk, government risk, you know, anything associated with government tenders, people do not want to touch. How do we address those risk factors and how do we rationalize around those?
Yeah. So these challenges, sorry, let me take it. These challenges becomes an asset. So you can't go to Bihar, maybe this fellow can go it. So invest it. Anyway, I think it's a matter of how do you emotionally connect on most of these issues. And I'll give you my elevator pitch again. Okay. Whenever I convince somebody to come as a co-investor when I'm chipping in money or what we do, not that all the time we succeed, but I can give you the little bit of the convincing that we do in this. So let's first talk about it. Look at the life of a businessman. Okay. Now let's look at like a movie playing in the background. This fellow works hard, creates a phenomenal business. Most of the kids gets educated in the Ivy League schools, so-called the Western world. They head back home because father says, you know, you come back and start taking care of my business. This fellow walks into the business, not knowing anything about the practical side of the business, but got phenomenal knowledge, best of the management educations he's bringing. And he walks into the business and see the class of, you can say, civilization there in a way. Because this fellow is not able to adjust to the way, more often than not, to the way the business was being conducted. He wants to radically transform it. And the father says, if you are going to do this, I mean, obviously these classes are very common and I don't need to get into details. So for a business family, there are three top priorities they carry always. And here I'm talking about business family as a high net worth and ultra high net worth individuals, because they are the people who need to be convinced about the social impact investing or early stage investing. There are three priorities they always carry in life. And these all priorities, the biggest wealth the business family has is their children. Okay? There's no wealth bigger than that. And what they need to essentially focus on their core area of wealth is three things. One, building capability in children. So they give them education and experience. Leaving enough wealth for them. And more importantly, making them educated, or you can say making them enough with value consciousness. So value education. The three things they leave behind: capabilities, wealth, and values. Now you can put it in whatever order. Here is, I'm not trying to build it. Now, if you have to leave all these three things together, what is one area which can give them all the three things together? So you've got your wealth, which needs to be taken care of, whether you do investment in an enterprise or whether you do purity of wealth by philanthropy. Maybe this is something which falls in between, that you are doing something, wealth creation along with social consciousness. When it comes to capability building, very often these young guys, when they come back to India, they have no clue how to run the business. This fellow has got 23, 24, 25 years of age, and he has to go and now become suddenly become a boss of somebody who is 45 years or 50 years, who is almost like his uncle, and maybe, and suddenly he has to get into the situation. And sometimes he is not able to adjust himself to the situation. Ask him to create a business where he has to hire a 40 years old. How is going to convince him? The best experience that he can get is to fine-tune all his management education by let the rubber meet the road and let's see how the friction is being handled. So possibly for him to get involved in a business is the best way. But more importantly, let him get involved in a business which also teaches him value. And that's where social impact investing comes in. So I always tell, whether you have a choice, whether you want to do it or not, you have no choice but to make your kids go through some kind of a business experience, and that too outside your family business. Now you may not pursue it for life. He may just get some few years of experience out of it, but let him have the experience of creating something where he can proudly say, yes, I am also capable of creating. And at the same time, if you can also inculcate value consciousness on top of it through social impact investing, then you got all the three things together. You have built the capability, you have built the value consciousness, and more importantly, you are also helping putting your wealth to right use. So you have to convince them logically, although you have emotions in the background.
Now, what I feel is that, see, one, philanthropy is for distress, like you have for, like you know, underprivileged children, flood victims, or orphanages, or old age homes. They are economically backward people beyond 60. So that is philanthropy for distress. So here it is, it's not exactly philanthropy, but contribution for development. So here we are looking not for distress. Distress is one part where you don't think and you just write out a check, whether it's flood victims or prime minister's relief fund. So you see large amounts of contributions coming from business families or social organizations. Here it is contribution to development. So when it comes to development, again, it need not go to the rationality of investment and return, but it could be towards development. And development is always accompanied by achievement. And that achievement could be in form of returns, could be in form of recognition, could be in form of being there and having done that. So it has to be looked at in a positive frame of mind, that you're contributing to the development, and the return would be not necessarily in a monetary form, but it would be in different forms. Whereas for a distressed philanthropy, the return is the satisfaction that you cannot go and actually help the flood victim, but you're writing a check to the Prime Minister's Relief Fund, and maybe food and water and medicines are being supplied there. So it's a different positioning, different thought process. It's for the development. It's economic development, it's development on the rural India, which has to come to the fore. And then I think the inclusion in the return and that will be separated, because we always link philanthropy to distress. It's not necessarily that. It's philanthropy also for development.
No. You want to add again a point on the same aspect?
What you just said, yeah.
Okay.
So I think Satya's wisdom in the family area is really powerful, and some insights which you said, what needs to be done with those families who got huge amount of wealth, and that's the formula which I see, CAVEW, you know, wealth, values, and whatever.
Capabilities.
Perfect. But I think the question really was also how to widen the base. Okay. And I think while one particular audience is people who've got large wealth because of family, but there's a huge number of people who come into disposable income. They are educated and they are urban. And that's the problem which Aditi said. That these people are in Bombay's and Delhi's and Calcutta's and Bangalore's. They've grown up in an urban environment. They don't understand Orissa. They don't understand poetry. They don't understand whatever it is. So there is a challenge. So they don't have large sums of money to invest, but they have something. They want to do that. And I'm actually sharing this as an experience because I have a set of young people who are executives who are kind of co-investing. They don't have huge wealth, but they want to do this, and what they like is this kind of stuff. So you have to use ways, whether it's technology, whether it's expertise of people who are from that particular sector to come along. I think you do it in a fashion by choosing mentors, etc., in that area, to convince these people, and convincing must come from people who are equally passionate in that area, but bring in knowledge and some past experience. And look, don't worry. I know real estate. Don't worry, I know poultry farming, etc. And what is being said out here in terms of productivity is possible or not possible. Bring in the expertise. Use technology. Use visual devices. You actually do Skype or I don't know, whatever it is. Go to the farmers. Talk to the farmers or whatever it is. And give them the confidence because they physically cannot go out there. And you can't expect them to understand the rural stuff because they're never thrown out there. So you have to use some of that and widen the net. There, and I can promise you there are lots of people out there who are, who will be in a position to invest. People come out in 4 years' time, they have EMIs to have houses, EMIs to buy cars, etc. So why wouldn't they be able to put a small amount and widen the base?
Absolutely. In fact, Naveen, the point that you've now brought up, when we moved from this, marrying the two objectives into this aspect, is what I want to sort of hear your perspective on, Amar, is this whole segmentation. I mean, within the high net worth category, there are many kinds. You have the ultra HNI and the family offices, and you have people also who are senior professionals, etc., who also are your target segment. So as a wealth advisor, as an intermediary, when you're talking about impact investments, one, I want your perspective on how would you, as of now, this is obviously not an asset class that you're in your current setup taking to clients. If you were to start taking it, who would you approach first and why? And why would you not approach a certain segment? And here I'm only generalizing on the basis of the size of wealth, right? I mean, even within that size of wealth, there are some, categories that you would not approach, and we're fine with that, which we talked about. But is there a graduated approach, or would you like to reach out to a large number of people if the choice was given to you and if your entity approved of it? How would you take it forward?
It could be a graduated approach. It could be to people who are aware about it, people who have that bent of mind, and where they would be able to allocate a certain portion without thinking about the returns, or without monitoring it on a
size of wealth player.
Size of the wealth is important. Also, what is important is their experience in the field, that they are aware about it, they are aware about impact, they are aware about the causes that they are going for. So it could be to a select people who are aware about it.
That's how you push.
Just add to it. So few things that I have seen working. One is, first and foremost, to convince people to get into this, you need to have obviously a very good elevator pitch, which is logical, but at the same time supporting the emotions behind. And if you get that right, you will at least excite them to get into something like this. But that's not good enough. You have to convert that excitement into some social impact or some early stage investment or some impact investing out of it. And to do that, very often what we have seen that the size of investment to begin with sometimes so small that it doesn't attract the attention of the big guys. And the smaller guys don't have adequate time to really focus on, because this is, again, while this is important, but they somehow don't get the right thing together. So I think here we have to follow two or three different combinations. One is that whenever you talk about some of these investment ideas, it has to come from people who have been screened for the viability, from both from the perspective of the idea as well as the entrepreneur. So ghoda or ghudsawar, if dono. No, they have already been filtered. I mean, once that process has been filtered, then obviously that's not good enough. you need again some credible investors to anchor it. And once you have one or two credible investors who have anchored it, then I don't think there is any dearth of follow-up investors. In fact, what we have been doing, I mean, in our business, and personally, because I am also personally passionate about what I am saying to you, but at the same time, I keep having this conversation with most of my business clients who are business families, is that while I understand this is too small an investment for you to be really bothered about or to spend time, which generally any investment would require, but at least you can come in as an investor to see the impact which is happening out of it, but just follow on if you already done some kind of a screening and got the anchor investor there. And generally they have seen, we have a good demand today. In fact, I have been personally looking around for investment ideas for our clients for doing it. And if there is any viable idea which is coming out of this forum, we are more than happy to support both personally as well as Barclays as an organization to see if we can conclude it for. I don't think there is any dearth of money. What is missing is the structure to take that money out from those families or out from those individuals. Because here we need more leaders than followers. We are right now following the followers. Okay. So we need to first create those anchor investors who believe in what we are doing and get those guys, write the check, believe in what we are doing.
Satya, just elaborate when you talked about structure, exactly what you mean by that?
So structure means that, okay, so let's say we are trying to raise $1 million or $2 million or $5 million. Now, instead of going and approaching those 50 different guys and saying, okay, let's do some small amount of money, let's raise at least 10% or 15% from those who really believe in the idea. So if I have an old age home kind of proposal, I go to Pranay, hey Pranay, this is a great idea that I've come across. Do you feel it's a good enough idea? Now, Pranay may just simply invest only 10% of that whole deal size. But once Pranay says, yes, I'm doing it, then balance 90% is not difficult
to
me.
The lead investor.
Yeah. So this is what we call.
Okay. Just switching out of immediately the one item that we debated for a fair length of time, Aditi, to just a little bit on the whole way this space has actually evolved in the West. It may be replicable, it may have elements of replicability, it may have none. But it's useful to just find out, if you've studied the whole way it's evolved in the West, are there any learnings which you think could apply?
Yeah, absolutely. So in the West, still, the foreign capital that I talked about, again, 95% of that foreign capital, or even more than that, has come from DFIs, development financial institution, governments of other countries that are giving to our country, which is quite incredible. Mm-hmm. But there are a few individual investors as well. So one of our partners is a network called Tonic, which is based in the Bay Area. Mm-hmm. And they are a collection of about 40 investors, high net worth individuals, some family offices in the US as well as Europe. Mm-hmm. And they have been investing in India, Africa, Latin America for a while, for about 7 years or so. So the way they have now started to think about it is also this, I completely agree with you, Pranay. So, to begin with, you have to think about, 10, 15% and even maybe less than that of your entire portfolio to invest in this. But some of them have actually now started doing 100% portfolio approach into impact. And what that means is very interesting. So it's not only these very risky, early stage, or even some of the later stage are considered risky impact investments, but also across traditionally what you would call instruments or asset classes. So they're parking their money in banks, which then use it responsibly. Mm-hmm. So they're not going to park their cash at a bank which invests in a coal mine, for example. So that's how they're parking their liquid assets. They're investing in property that is being used either, affordable housing, or that is being used for encouraging entrepreneurs, space, that kind of stuff. They are putting debt in countries where they're allowed to put in debt, and they're putting in equity as well. And so it's more like responsible investing in a way, and a part of that is intentionally creating bottom of the pyramid impact. But basically that's how it's evolved. And it's interesting as we talk about switch the two gears, because these guys are the furthest away from the ground, but their risk appetite is really high. Mm-hmm. I think that's the difference between the Western investors, especially in the US, the individuals, and the Indian individual investors is one, risk appetite, and they're so far away that they're okay with not knowing Orissa. They're okay with not knowing Bihar, they're okay with not knowing UP. So I think this is very important. And so just quickly to share, so Tonic, this portfolio over the last 7 years, I think has, they've tracked the performance, they're very public sharing it, has outperformed the S&P. This 100% impact portfolio.
And it's over a period as well.
That's over 7 years.
Over 7 years. So essentially what you talked about, I mean, at a very broad level, is that it is not necessarily the way we debated it here, an asset class, but it is actually a way of investing. It, you know, it moves across asset classes from cash to debt to equity. Nidhi, I'm just a little conscious of time because we want to keep time for questions, because there's just one thing which we want to debate, and Satya will take your views on that as well, is if I relate that back into the Indian context, one of the things which was actually made available some time back, and it started not very long ago, but probably about 2 to 3 years ago, is apart from equity, where you're putting money into an early stage company's equity, securitized debt, where you're securitizing the debt portfolio, maybe microfinance companies, etc. And then, you know, you're actually structuring that and making that available to a much wider basket. And here, you're going back to that original question, the risk-return equation is absolutely commensurate. So you have a 90-day paper or a 180-day paper, and you know your return is slightly higher than what, say, a debt mutual fund would offer, which makes it eminently palatable, not necessarily only to people with a social conscience, but to any investor. So it naturally widens the basket. You would still have only a certain category which would subscribe to it, but again, it's an attempt at widening. So my question to both Amar, you and Satya is, are these, is the market right or ripe to actually sort of have more of these as well and move into what Aditi described as, you know, not just look at it as one high risk asset class as we discussed, but something which is actually a way of investing in probably every asset class.
Can I just add one small thing before it's opened up?
Yeah.
You talked about debt, you talked about equity. There are other ways of helping the startups. Let me give you an example. The startup is saying that, look, I can't afford the Bombay rentals if I need to operate out of here, but the market is here and I just have to be in Bombay. So what one angel investor is doing, he's saying that, look, I'm giving you the space, you don't pay me any rent whatsoever for the first 3 years. It's rent free, you know, and that's my contribution, that's my support, you
that's
know, to you kind of getting started on this. It's neither equity nor debt, but you're just kind of supporting a venture.
Absolutely.
By giving them that elbow room, which is otherwise missing. You know? This was just one example.
Absolutely.
Yeah. You can. Oh.
Yeah.
I would feel that. I would feel that. One shouldn't fragment it into smaller pieces, the funding, and should be with the people who are interested, and it should be a way of investing with a long-term outlook and not a short-term outlook, because that may result in confusion in the minds of people of what they're doing exactly. So I think it shouldn't be fragmented into smaller pieces. It should be with select investors who have the thought process and who have, like both Naveen and Pranay said, understand the business that they are investing into. Maybe it's making pumps or lamps in villages, because again, poultry in Orissa, know the state and know the business of poultry. So it's from that attitude and that mindset that we should approach and shouldn't fragment it.
So to just summarize, what you're saying is you stick to equity and longer term in a graduated manner, going to the ultra HNIs first, rather than try to get a wider base. Satya, quickly your perspective before we
I think
open it
securitization
up.
Is something is going to work. I mean, we have been hopeful, and I'm personally very keen to for it to reach to the investors directly, so that these books or these portfolios can be directly funded from the investors who are socially conscious. At the same time, they are getting the returns, reasonable returns on this. And I think this can pay much better than the bank FDs to most of the guys,
and
provided we are able to do it.
Widen that base?
Now, the challenge here is not related to whether this portfolio is coming out of social impact ventures, but it's largely to do with the structure of the debt market in India. It is largely an institutional market, unfortunately. Regulators, a lot of institutions have been working hard to make the Indian debt market far more direct and to have the disintermediation done. But somehow, for one reason or other, it has not succeeded. I personally believe that maybe this could be another way to take the step forward and take the some of the securitized paper directly to investors, and happy to work on it. Now let me also give you, now not only the securitized debt going to the investors, I can give you some more structural support which you can provide it. I recently come across a couple of interesting ventures in social impact space, and to be very honest, it's very unfortunate I could not spend time with them. These guys were really pinging me very now and then, saying, okay, I'm looking for money here, I'm looking for money there, and I used to always defer them, not this weekend, next weekend, next to next weekend, and this process, we lost almost a month. And finally, I realized that I'm still not able to spend and do justice with them. So what I realized that these guys are looking for a small amount of money, roughly about 350,000 US, to be very precise. And I was really debating whether am I doing justice by keeping these guys on hold, or shall I do something different with these guys. And I was very convinced on what these guys were doing. But I, frankly enough, before I say yes, take the step forward, I wanted to be convinced through some kind of a due diligence done, whether what I understand is right. And this is something which happened a couple of years back, actually. So I can share the whole history, the journey of it. You know, there is interesting debt. There is a good amount of debt available in the system which we are not aware of. There's a government scheme, okay, and this is a government scheme in India called CGTMS, which says that anybody who is a graduate can look for funding for their viable projects, okay, up to 1 crore, $250,000 US without any collaterals. So very simple, if there is a good viable project, if somebody is willing to learn it, let him go through the process of appraisal. Now the challenge was, this was such a small project, no chartered accountant is willing to work for. It doesn't meet his cost of going and working with the branches and fill so many papers when these guys do not even have accounts to submit. So what I told few of the chartered accountants who were in part of my network, I said, guys, I'll pay you the fees. What's your charges? I'll pay you the fees, whether you succeed or not. But you go through them in the process of the CGTMS approval. If these guys succeed, it means there is some viability and there is a banker who has already established some amount of viability, and he would be far more conservative than maybe as an investor we would be. And this idea succeeded. Those guys got finally bank funding. And you know what happened? These guys said that we don't need any more equity. So I don't even want your money. Because the moment there is a bank funding of substantial amount available, there are enough people who are willing to contribute to it within their friends and families. So they got more credibility within their own network than possibly they had. Satya, so by the way, in none of these cases we have to fund the equity.
Sorry, we've run out of time, but I'm going to live on borrowed time and just, yeah, for the next 5 minutes, ask for questions.
10 minutes.
Ask them to address their questions to any particular member.
I'll make this very quick. My,
if you want to ask the question to a particular member, feel free to do.
Okay, it's actually to the whole panel. I work with an organization that, among other things, encourages student entrepreneurship through a challenge and subsequent incubation. So it's very heartening to hear that there are various perspectives to investing. And this is a very shameless pitch. We are looking for money. How do we knock on your door and have the right script so that one of you or all of you give me the time and say, hey, it's a great idea, I'm willing to hear you out. And we're looking at grant sponsorship, anything. And I have brochures if we can talk later, but
Satya,
it's basically how do I appeal to you?
We all have our contact numbers and the mail IDs in public domain in any case. There are many more investors actually. There are so many co-investors sitting here in the panel, in this room. So I think there are a lot many people who can support you.
We'll hear the next question.
I'm Manish Balwani from Value Creation Catalyst. I come from the wealth background, and now I'm channelizing funds, CSR funds for NGOs. So good to be in a debate which is talking about more of impact and less of returns. Now I give you a live case. I'm working on this NGO, and they are working for old poor, slum old people, senior citizens now. And as it is always known, even CSR has its own fashion of investments. You know, education is in limelight, then energy is in limelight. So people are not ready to fund for project on old age people. The rudest replies that we've got is, why do you want to go after them? They are poor, they've already lived their life. They won't give you any returns. Let's do something, you know, rural livelihood or urban poor livelihood,
we will build India. No, that's the future of India. So, I would want to know, other than the elevator pitch that is there, other than the elevator pitch, what can we be, what can we do? Because I'm always also involved in developing financial strategies for the same, or if we can come together and have new financial products for the same. I mean, can something be done? And the direct competition is Dignity Foundation. And if you see Dignity Foundation, it charges a bomb. It charges a bomb to the rich old. Same if we have to replicate in the slums, very difficult. It's backed by a very big corporate. Here, how do we channel? Other than the elevator pitch, what else needs to be done? It's a live case. If this gets solved, oh, great. Thank you.
I just intervene here. Can we take the questions and the ones which are really relevant to what we are discussing, we actually answer? Because otherwise, we'll run out of time.
Thanks. My name is Sri Krishna. I'm with a fund called United Seed Fund. We're trying to raise probably one of the first India funds focused on impact. We're one third the way in our target of trying to raise around 60 crore or 10 million. The challenge has been we've been reaching out to multiple folks in the wealth fraternity. Going back to Satya's point where you say, you know, it's all about convincing the client. I think my challenge is convincing the gatekeeper to the client to actually get to them. So would love any thoughts or feedback that you might have on that. I think it's, you know, the folks like you that are rather running the wealth groups completely understand what we're doing and get very excited. As it starts to trickle down to the guys that manage the product, they're like, oh, this is not going to make enough money. Our relationship managers are not going to get excited selling it. But the RMs are very interested and they want to sell it because they think that this is a very interesting product and the clients haven't seen it before. So this is the challenge that we're battling with. Would love inputs either offline or right away. Thanks.
Maybe we'll take it. Okay. I can respond to it right now if you want. The response is not that there's nothing wrong with your concept. The challenge is that more often than not, the blind pool funds in India, okay, have not delivered what they committed, okay, for whatever reasons. And I'm not trying to find fault with anybody. So today we have got into a situation where anybody who comes and says, okay, give me the money and I will finally deliver, whether it's economic returns or whether it's social return, people are not getting convinced about it. So it's a question of their belief in the investors' belief in you, that whether you are going to ultimately deliver what you're committing. And it's difficult to establish these track records, to be very honest. So what I would suggest for most people that do want to do investment, that instead of going for blind pool, you go for project specific investment. Instead of 10 million, you might even end up raising 100 million. But the difference is here you will have to take the step where showcasing what you want to do in a specific project, then collecting it.
Hi, I'm Parul Gupta. I work in Citi Private Bank, but in London. So I've been only looking at the global investments. And this is my question. I think this will be more for Aditi and Satya to respond to. When I started looking at the background of impact investing, the idea was that there's a certain amount of money going into philanthropy, but there's trillions of dollars sitting in capital markets, and we need to access that. So let philanthropy do its thing, and we should access the other parts of the, you know, other investors. So I'm looking at the target investors. But then it started coming out that when we started looking at our target customers and I started talking to the private bankers, more and more they started saying, oh, this is easier to convince the guys who are already doing philanthropy to cut a bit of their portfolio, which is going to philanthropy, and give it to recycling of investments. So we never really thought of going to clients who are doing it just for private equity, 20%, 25%. So that's the case which I see in UK and US. Coming to India, looks like we kind of can use this for, as Satya said, like people who are not really doing much philanthropy to expand their philanthropic base and use this idea of impact investing to give more than they would have otherwise. It's still philanthropic, but it's just expanding the base because philanthropy is already happening a lot abroad. We're just asking them to cut a part of their portfolio. Here we use impact investing to grow the philanthropic base. So, I mean, this is a different use, and I would just want to say, like, and Tonic is one which can actually appeal to guys who are actually capital markets. Are there that kind of things in India, more of such funds which can give you a little bit, which can appeal to guys who are not just doing for philanthropy? Yeah.
That's a really good question. And in fact, last week I was at Oxford, there was an impact investing program. There were people from over 20 countries, and this was one of the things that came up. So you have two ends of the spectrum. How do you come to the middle? From where does it come, right? And I think initially, so Tonic is a network just like us, and so it's individual decisions that are being made, so I just wanted to clarify that. In India as well, that's, I think, what we're seeing, and I think initially that's how it's going to be. And I think our endeavor is to push and get more money from the capital markets, from the portfolio. You know, I think most of our members, and I think, I'll ask Jayesh Bhai as well, he's sitting here, are doing this with their, let's play with this money. This is the money that they've kept aside to play with. So not coming from their serious investments. And I do, we have a whole range of people who will invest in different types of projects. Some people will go for very impactful stuff, they don't care about returns. Some people will say, okay, I do really care about scale and return plus impact, right? So you have, it's heterogeneous, but I do think it is coming in their minds from the money that they can play with, which was earlier kind of going into philanthropy.
To add one more thing before we go to Jayesh, one of the things which I saw is a lot of the family offices, when you had this debt securitization product, who separately give money to philanthropy, even though it's the same person or the same family office, this, a different set of people handle, looked at it purely as a return-oriented asset class, looked at the risk-reward equation, and made a very rational decision on allocating a certain part of it. So I think one of the ways of widening the base or sort of getting a larger set of people and not just attracting more of the philanthropic capital is probably to look at it as a way of investing. I know there were differing perspectives here, but to look at the more safer asset classes, because those would be easier for certain people to understand and access.
Salai, Jayesh. Jayesh, would you like to? Yeah.
I think it's, can you hear me? Can you hear me? Yeah. It's not so technical in my personal case. I allocate a certain amount of funds, as Aditi mentioned, to angel investing. So I come not from the philanthropy saying, okay, I'm going to direct some of my philanthropic dollars into impact investing. I'm an angel investor, and so I already take high risk and expect high returns. And in this particular case, that angel investment is going into impact investing. With the same set of terms, except that now I'm getting what you all call double bottom line, which is great.
I'll share with you a very interesting answer which it came, and it's a very, very, very powerful message which I got. And this was a debate which we had with few business families. I was fortunate to be part of that inner courtyard discussion. And there was a debate whether we should talk about philanthropy, we should talk about social impact investing. And very interesting conversation came, and it will resonate well for those who can relate it from a spiritual perspective. He says, when I talk about philanthropy, okay, we come from a concept of Gupta Dan, secret donation, so that what I am doing should not be known to anybody. Very good. And when it comes to social impact investing, I can talk about it openly. Very good, convincing answer. But he came up with a very much more evolved answer. And the old answer was that when I talk about philanthropy, whether it's a Gupta or not Gupta, whether secret or not secret, there is some amount of feeling which I get inside me that I'm sympathizing with the guy or the particular purpose that I'm giving. Oh, he's poor, so I'm giving something. This fellow is distressed, so I'm giving something. This fellow needs medical help, I'm giving something. Still, there is a feeling of aham bhav, karta bhav, from a spiritual, those who from connected with Gita will get to know. So I'm getting a feeling I have done something with somebody. But when it comes to social impact investing, I do away with that aham and karta bhav. So for me, this is far more fulfilling because I don't get any feeling I have done something. In fact, these guys are doing something by providing return out of my investment. So I should be obliged to them. So basically, it came in a very different way. So actually, it need not to compete with philanthropic capital when it comes to social impact investing. And you can provide a logical answer why it should be seen separately as compared to philanthropic pool.
So, sorry, on that note, I've been getting these urgent signals from Nidhi. We have to, unfortunately, thank you for a very, very active thank you to the panelists, and thank you for the audience.
No,
thank you. Thank you so much. Thanks. Thanks so much for coming, Naveen.